Visited William Herschel's It's 11:41 Central Standard Time. We turn our clocks back. We're looking at a variety of sky conditions. Most locations reporting cloudy skies with temperatures from the mid 50s to the mid 30s for the most of the days. There's clouds to the monuments in the Mariner and the Academy of St. Martin. This is Mozart's Bassoon Concerto. Thank you.
I Thank you.
It's a minute before noon central standard time. I guess we can say this is the classical Minnesota community. Celebrating the energy of our kids, the power of classical music. outstanding young artists and inspirational teachers are transforming classroom music. As our host, the great concert pianist, Christopher O'Reilly.
Thank you. Welcome, everybody. Special thanks to our host, Carnegie Hall World Conservatory at Chicken Burger, for bringing this back to New York. And as if performing at Carnegie Hall weren't enough to raise the blood pressure of the talk show today, we're going to need to thank the audience here at some of America's best and teachers. The Music Teachers National Association for Business in Town needs to have a teachers to crash our show on us. Well, we welcome you, all of you people who have made our show possible. And we hope today's show will offer you some inspiration to continue the great work that you do. In addition to meeting the amazing kids on today's show, we're going to learn about a music education initiative recently launched by friends here at Carnegie Hall and the Royal Conservatory of Music in Carnegie Hall. It's called the Carnegie Hall Royal Conservatory Achievement Program, and it provides a national standard for measuring musical success. It's for a defined curriculum of study with their teachers, and then track their accomplishments in a way that's consistent with peers across the country. It's the U.S. version of the program that's been highly successful in Canada for many years. And at the end of our show, we'll be meeting an outstanding young pianist who's been participating in that program for 10 years. The first violin violist, performed by a superb musician from Charlottesville, Virginia. Please welcome 17-year-old Maddie Best. Thank you. just a plot of address. So I think there's really no reason to believe that it's an address, but they're really, really beautiful. Thanks, Ryan. The young man standing on stage with me now has brought his job good across the country to join us at Live Revolt. He's a 14-year-old from Los Angeles, California. His name is Ashwin Krishna. Ashwin, you're playing a piece by a fellow California artist that you're in the
movies. How are we playing the introduction of some of those playing the world? Thank you.
So let's get priority school. What's your big advice? What's your least favorite?
History. I'm bad at it.
History is just a series of times. You're familiar with your second favorite, which is why your plan is quite impressive, but tell me who your mandatory heroes are.
Well, I really look up to Don very musical and precise in the use of the chorus justice.
You do very well. Priority three, voice acts. I understand you were upset.
Yeah, it's fine, but I'm not sure.
students at the Hewlett School of Creek College Division. My number is Yota Violin, Junior Wan Shu, Viola, Junshu Wan Chao, and Yu Chong Yuan Kim. Their coach is coming from the top, coming in. In addition to hearing great young classical musicians today, we're learning about the Carnegie Hall Royal Conservatory Achievement Program. We're going to talk now with two key people behind its launch. Bruce Lovin, the executive and artistic director of Carnegie Hall, Bob Benson, and the president of the Royal Conservatory of Music and Drama, Dr. Peter Simon. Has sponsored programs like this for over 125 years. Can you describe how it works and its impact? Achievement program, which is credited now, provides students and teachers with a vast resource of wonderful repertoire for study, which has been carefully sequenced according to a progression of musical concepts. And within each of these levels, students will play music that can be very classical. Romantic and contemporary areas and also help with the study of music theory and history and the development of oral reading skills. So it's a comprehensive program that creates a really rich learning environment for students. Assessments that are connected to each year then provide a positive and meaningful feedback about progress and the professionalism of the adjudicators really provides a consistency for the national standard. In terms of the Canadian experience, the impact of the program with this has been immense. 99% of the participants in the program don't go on to become concert pianists, but they form the core of a society that really believes in this. And because of the standards of the program, government treats it with the same value as other educational initiatives and provided a tax credit for independent music study and credits in high school. Decided to describe something for the United States in a similar program. And the Carnegie Hall should take a leadership role in making it happen. What makes this so important? Well, if you've ever been with one known Carnegie Hall as the destination or any great musician else, I think it will have to be the venue essentially. It's that we are absolutely central to the implementation of music education with popular values. And so we've undertaken many, many projects we work on. School system here, we work with orchestras around the country, working with school, their work within schools. We do many, many things about schools, about kids, about engagement in the community, but we also do a tremendous amount about the direction of the family. And so, even looking at how we can do this, we really think there, we can look around who could be the best possible partner. And we think the Royal Conservatory program was so good. That we felt they would make a new partner. And we need to do a lot of things to accomplish it. But the club is a partner, and it's one of the people working with MGMA as a partner. We feel the best things are done in partnership, but they have to be in partnership with people who share the values. And I think that's why this really works, why we think it's important, because we both believe in the same thing. So people can enunciate what the value is, and we tell people that. And this is all about the development of the human individual and how all of us will collaborate. Is it everybody knows? And in the end, it's going to be a beloved program. certainly something that absolutely serves teachers, gives them the tools, the resources to help with their teaching, and you know, for the plan for the development of their students. It's an exciting and aspiration for students and for parents. So I think that's what it'll look like, that's what we aspire to do, and I think we will be able to take much of it. Now, if we've got coming up, we can always see exactly what success looks like. It sounds really clear to me, but if you don't finish this product, it'll be very training for the group that it has to do. Generally, a very good time, and I'm very thankful for being in the school of it. We're so, so good. Executive and Artistic Director of Carnegie Hall, and Dr. Peter Simon, the President of the Royal Conservatory of Music in Canada.
I feel wondering what it would be like to see these amazing performers in action, not over 30 to today. They are the founding members of the Toronto, behind the scenes speakers, even content created by the young musicians themselves. Go to youtube.com/countertop.
Support for NPR comes from NPR member stations and from U.S. Docs, believing that the arts have a work all their own in stimulating the hearts and imaginations of our country's best young musicians. From the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, recognizing exceptionally creative individuals, this year's MacArthur Fellows are Anton Gavia. And from the Giants and James L. Knight Foundation, helping NPR advance journalistic excellence in particular ways. This is NPR.
There may still be hope for that old, dusty form of your bed.
We have three computer internet students, sharing one students. They had to check it out and take it home. As luck would have it, after we start the program, to play it.
Make that phone sing for someone else. Go to classicalnpr.org/edit forward and donate your used instruments to a screening room.
There's more coming up just ahead at Classical Minnesota Public Radio, supported this afternoon by the University of St. Thomas School of Law. Nationally ranked 8th in 2012 for best professors by the Princeton Review. More about joining this learning community at stthomas.edu/law.
NPR, it's From the Top, celebrating the energy of America's kids and the power of classical music. This week, coming to you from Carnegie Hall in New York City. Coming up, making your pianist performs Butterflies and Wildcats, and exciting piece by the contemporary Canadian composer David McIntyre. From the Top's on the Human Conservatory, where outstanding young artists and inspirational teachers are transforming classical music. The Carnegie Hall performance is made possible by the Carnegie Hall Royal Conservatory of TV.
Thanks, Joanne. Joining us now is a terrific 18-year-old flutist from Roseville, Minnesota. Please welcome Karen Pondell. Karen, you brought one of the most remarkable pieces of solo flute, Kelly and Williams. Thank you. Northeast in Roseville, Minnesota, from Union College in Roseville. Yeah, it's all about that pick up the news, and she was teaching from Union College in Minnesota, also the program of Minnesota, but the early with the best high school age, high school positions in the state. It's all over the map, and it's really had in there just such a comprehensive community. All the way into the, all the, the talent of all of the nation, and it's really, it's really.
Well, my dad plays trombone, my other brother plays trumpet, my second oldest brother plays trombone, and my sister plays.
Your twin sister?
My twin sister.
I was quite touched when I read about your relationship with your twin sister. You have twins that you share before. You know, they can never spend time together, or they always get out of your place. Very close?
Yeah, we're really close. We have all the same interests. She's interested in music and stuff just like I am. And we just do everything together. We can talk about anything for hours, which is incredibly fun.
If it's right there now, I know also from the introduction, your favorite color is orange. Is her favorite color when you go?
No, she doesn't really have a favorite color, but she thinks I'm really bad and orange is my favorite color.
It's a good color. Now, not only are you close to your twin sister, you are practically inseparable.
Yes, we are. Before I had any of my college graduations, I had spent more than 16 hours away from her. And this will be the longest time I've been
with her. That's apparent. We had to lose spots for her. Your sister couldn't come to the door, but we didn't want her to be completely missing her out of existence, or for you to miss her with two of them. So we had your sister on the phone the entire time with her. Esther, are you there? So how do you think your sister did on both
sides? It was really, really good. Everything was like so flawless. And I felt after I was this sounded really, really good.
Karen, nice surprise.
Yes.
You want to ask Esther what the writer's like out there in Minnesota right now?
What's the weather like?
It's very, really good. It was a very, really sunny day, and the temperature is really perfect.
Esther, any parting words?
I love you, and I'll see you there. So you can get to see the New York plane.
Say goodbye.
Bye.
So you have an incredibly close relationship with your sister Esther, and I know that your parents really come to you for you, too. So how about you know what you're doing here for you?
Well, the thing I'm hoping, it was the next step I needed. We basically set up with this book, and it was really expensive, and we didn't really have the money for it. So we actually remortgaged our house to get it for me.
Right. It's like, it's quite a unique thing.
It is.
Well, I hope we can help take some of the pressure off. You're getting one of our $10,000 check with the artist there. So congratulations.
Thank you.
Carrie Baumgartner, 18 years old from Roseville, Minnesota.
From the top.org, from the top of your hospital, part of the Jack Van Dyke Foundation, advancing the education of students with exceptional talents in their financial aid. On the web at jvcf.org.
We're taking time today to recognize a newsworthy national education initiative. It's the Chronicle World Conservatory Achievement, and it's designed to take students of any age and virtually any instrument from the beginning years to the highest level of proficiency. And what the students involved in this course of study to think about it. We got in touch with somebody to find out.
I'm Sydney Ellen Moore. I'm 15 years old. I'm from Lowell, Massachusetts. And I'm from the Achievement Program. The Achievement Program for me is great. The best aspect of it, I think, is kind of forcing me to focus really on the technique. Before I started the Achievement Program, I would stop off on my skills and projects. I really do them every day. And having a goal to reach that I need to learn these skills, these opportunities, these things to really pushed me to meet the level to meet that was expected for that level of the Achievement
understanding of theory behind music. It's a great way to market a repertoire. It's a great challenge. And it's a great way to be prepared for music as a course in college.
I'm J.P. Redmond, and I'm 12 years old. I live in Hastings, on Hudson, New York, and I play piano. Yeah, we have scales and other exercises, and play 5 pieces, 3 pieces, 2 8s, and then they have you do ear training and sight reading. I like all of that stuff because they're challenging. They help you get better. Can I tell you what I don't feel like? And I was scared about sight reading. During my first exam, the examiner gave me a short piece of sight read in G minor. So that was hard and difficult. Just because the sight read something was complex. When I messed up sometimes, I kind of freaked out with sight reading. But it's an experiment. My name is Layla Maddox. I'm 17. I'm from Park Ridge, Illinois, and I play piano. After so many years studying and doing the achievement program, I really never wanted to give up because it's not only a good program, it's sort of becoming a voice that I can't find my own voice to express myself. I can always speak something.
I'm 18 years old. I'm from Calgary, Alberta, and I'm 30. I've been in the Canadian version of the achievement program for 10 years. At first, the program, I guess, seemed very strict. I knew it was a bit intimidating, but after many years of doing it, it works in a manner that is gradual and careful. They introduce new ideas and new techniques and look for steadily push you, so therefore it allows you to grow at a pace that you're going to need the most. Please say welcome to the man behind the last voice you heard, our client for the day, 18-year-old famous Ben Bowles. As you just said in that piece, you're the product of 10 years of this training. And after all that, I've been said you're looking for a life in you. What sort of career do you see for yourself?
Well, I think as a future career, I would like to work with people through music. And like many other musicians, I do aspire to be a concept artist. However, a concept artist can be limiting in many ways. In the sense only a select group of people become concept artists. And in the sense that only a select group of people love classical music with a true passion. And I think music's ultimate purpose is to connect the human race so that you may be able to truly love and understand one another. And that is why I kept going to music that isn't so mainstream in America and Canada. That music includes a lot of world music. I truly love Indian and Arabic music, but I also like to listen to musicians who perform in smaller venues who have enormous talent that go pretty much unrecognized. And it's truly amazing to experience just people singing and rather beautiful voice. So it's like really well. I do usually study Argentina and China, so we have a good international options. I see there as a future of a musical Joseph Campbell pulling all these different cultures together musically. And rather than the creative spirit. I will be playing a piece called Joe Has Bobcats. It is composed by the Canadian
David Lawson, and the production managers of Elizabeth Gore. Technical direction by Darrell Burnett, David Forth, and John Surrey's. Post-production by Tom Baker. Thanks to the staff and crew at Carnegie Hall. The executive producers of Gerald Sutton and Jennifer Holly Rose. I'm Jerry Robinson. From the top of the independent nonprofit organization based in Boston. Our founding partners are the Lehman Conservatory and Melbourne TV agency. To download an application to appear on the program, visit fromthetop.org.
Support for NPR comes from NPR member stations and from the George Lucas Educational Foundation, Freedom of Edutopia, a source for Black Voices in Education. Learn more at edutopia.org. From the William T. Grant Foundation, supporting research to improve the lives of young people, online at wtgrantfoundation.org. And from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, dedicated to the idea that all people deserve the chance to live healthy, productive lives at gatesfoundation.org. This is NPR. Enjoy From the Top every Sunday afternoon, starting at noon, at Classical Minnesota Public Radio, 995 KSJM, Minneapolis, St. Paul. Streaming online at classicalnpr.org. Find us on Facebook and Twitter, too. A quick look at our website, classicalnpr.org, and you'll find links to the latest news headlines and the forecast. I hope you'll stay tuned to Classical Minnesota Public Radio just ahead of this evening.
This is Symphony Cast from APM, American Public Media. I'm Allison Young. A couple of years ago, a documentary was released called Sing, Swing, Swing. At first glance, one could think that it's about jazz or dance, even music education. But the movie features a young French pianist, Dominique Fred, who's known for making exaggerated movements of the keyboard and actively drawing out the music of this kind. The music does fit, and you have the benefit of seeing the play at work. In Frey's hands, it's like a young Mozart has returned to that scratch, full of vigor and life. You can almost imagine what this might be for young Mozart himself, in a comedy's show off a little bit, bubbling over with a joy that. This week we're in Texas with Joachim Sweden and the Dallas Symphony Orchestra, and they're joined by Debbie Craig, who looks like Grand Children No. 20. Welcome to APS Symphonycast. Today's broadcast is made possible in part by a generous grant from John D. Huss of the Huss Foundation, celebrating the beauty of great music in everyday life. Symphonycast this week is from the stunning Meyerson Symphony Center in Dallas. It's beautiful to look at. IMK designed the sleek, modern exterior of Judd Vandals, and inside is a more traditional European style shoebox concert hall. It's all warm and wood. So we have something that looks great and sounds fabulous. We'll welcome a pianist used to playing in traditional concert houses all over the world, and first, we start this concert with a piece that is ideally suited for the warmth and intimacy this hall affords. Surely a work of great intimacy, a birthday present from Wagner to his young wife, Rosanne, which doubled as a Christmas present since it was all happening on the same day. The musicians on that day in 1870 entered the Wagner's home on the banks of Loch Lossanne quietly, and they serenaded a still drowsy prisoner. The title of the work honors a lullaby for the newborn son. Here's Joachim Sweden with the Dallas Symphony Orchestra. We've heard Wagner's